Well, hello everyone, this is Mike Check 95 here with my cohort Krieger Margin and special guest Rain, and Booger is currently sleeping at the moment. We just finished episode 1-2, The Fall of the House of Usher, and unsettling and unnerving are probably the two correct adjectives. Probably the two correct adjective for this series so far. What do you think?
Actually, yes, I don't feel comfortable. That's for sure. Well, some shows you get a sense to where you feel comfortable, and you know what to expect. Like Hill House, you know there's going to be some ghosts or something, right?
No.
And this, you have no idea what the hell's going on. That very end scene was such unexpected jump scare. I was like, okay, well this is a setup episode. Get everybody kind of into the story of it and the world building. And then he's gonna get his car, and then we're gonna go, and the sitting in the car, like, yeah, Jester.
They wrote
like,
it to where they try to bring into that story, like, that make was, you make, make you good. Feel like you're glued to the screen, and all of a sudden, hello, here's a demon clown.
Yeah, that's like, oh, shit. And then I was like, oh, maybe he'll get in the car, and he has to see these things, but nobody else can see them or something. Like, that's really fucked up. I was like, oh, shit, is he dead? Oh, no, he's not dead, but he's like, oh, it's begun. Like, what do you mean it's begun?
So, I didn't really think that many
It's like
things.
The Lord of the Rings one where it has begun. I have quite a few. Okay, I was going to say, I have quite a few points. If you wanted to run through kind of your thoughts on the episode.
Yeah, mine are pretty short and sweet. I was trying to figure out where the show was being pinpointed on, but I think that the main part where he's talking to the detective is going to be set in modern times, but there's going to be a lot of time jumping, I feel like, from here and there. So I feel like that it's not really a set timeline. It's very...
Yes.
It's like a set of series of short stories put into one thing. Like he's basically telling all these stories in one setting, and it's just jumping from timeline to put all the stuff together. Detective, like,
I feel like the way that they're gonna be doing, sorry to cut you off there, I feel to touch on that point, I feel like what they're doing, and they've kind of laid this apart just like on Bly Manor. They're telling a story going all the way back in time, and it's going to jump between it started out on the spectrum. One's in really far back, and then in 1953, and the other one's in 2023. And then you're going to start, it's going to start linking back and forth. So it's going to take turns between the furthest and the newest until it gets close together, and it's going to lead up to some kind of final thing. I think that's going to be at that house where
yeah.
they're at.
My the other thing I was going to say is it's going to be like detective like horror. Like, I mean,
that's my
it's like a detective like movie, but there's like a horror element to it. But I feel like after watching that, it's going to be more so of the viewer doing the detective work and not us watching the detective doing the detective work. So it's a view.
Yes. So it with that being said, obviously, I have two suspects that I am guessing on. Who are the suspects that you were thinking about who might be the one, kind of based on what you've seen? Because they kind of set it up. Because remember, the sister said, "I'll be able to tell when we hand out the paperwork."
I'm not really
so
too
like, hey,
sure
who you think's
on the suspect
do it.
Part. I'm more so thinking that something was like, I think like a silent deal was made between Roderick and Madeline and that bartender back in 1979. And I think that bartender has something like witchcraftian or like paranormal-ish, like tied to them. So I think that bartender's linked to it all.
Yeah, I feel. Well, and that's why I was kind of saying with the well, on my notes I had put that, you know, she took the drink with them. That could be her. That could be like signing the deal kind of thing, because she said your life's going to become, you know, better. It's going to be completely different. Is what she said, not better. And then whenever she said, a deal you will make with the future.
It just makes you just want
to. I was like, interesting.
Yeah.
Reminds me of like a Crossroads demon from Supernatural or something like that. If you have watched that fantastic TV show. So my suspects. Well, before I get to it, do you have, who's your most suspected person if you had to guess?
I would probably have to say.
And we can go episode by episode, see if we're right or not.
White-haired sister, I think, or a girl. I didn't catch the character's name. She was the one that was like watching all the news, news channels and everything. I don't know. It seemed like she could be one because she's.
She
didn't look like she was in the loop with everything.
Yeah. So my thought on it was, I have two suspects, because number one, obviously the director wanted us to try to focus on that scene to try and read the people any clues. So I had two things. First of all, said clues of all of the people, the most one that was like against it was actually the wife to me, reading on her reactions. When they put it down, she looked disgusted at the paper. She looked at like a top corner of the thing. She didn't immediately, she was one of the only people that actually even open it up to read it at all. So that has some concern for me. And then at the same time, I know they like doing twists and things like this, so I was thinking, they said it's somebody from within their inner circle, one of their family members. Why would it not be the sister? Because the brother is the one who inherited all the stuff, because he's the older brother and he's the one in charge. And the sister, there might be a jealousy angle, you know. She doesn't have any kids. He's had 5 kids. Where's her kids at? Did she just never have kids? She wanted herself? Like, whatever the dark secrets are, she's got to be just as involved as he is. And they've mentioned that the 3 kids are dead, but they hadn't said anything about the sister, right? Not yet. Okay.
Yeah.
So that's my guess on that.
Was this is a very dysfunctional family, as you can tell, because they don't seem like they cannot get along whatsoever, and they're not pulling any punches. I feel like they're just letting everything just go full swing, from like the way they're putting the scenes out, the dialogue, the monologuing, all the line. I just feel like everything is just hitting you hard, pretty much.
The graphic, usually in shows, if there's a little bit of cussing, there's a little bit of cussing. But even the narrator cussing, it's like, that's just how just raw that is. That's throwing me off, because you don't really see, you know, like, God kissed the holy fuck out of my mother. A calm narrator usually doesn't say shit like that.
Oh, my.
They set the scene.
I think it has something to do with the edginess when it comes to pose, I guess, work and whatnot.
Well, that's what's making it so uneasy, is because it doesn't. Usually, a narrator will set you into the scene, and they're kind of set the table. Wait,
what are you talking about?
But this one's just like, holy shit! What the fuck do you mean? Kissed the fuck out of my mom, and my mom's coming. Mom's zombified, and then she kills the dude, and then dies. Like, what's that about? It's also very ironic if they did make a deal with the devil, when their mom was completely like, again, like a true elitist when it came to religion. Like, they would have broke everything that she believed in to do that.
That's pretty much it. Like, I was more wrapped into the story, trying to figure out like what was going on and trying to piece everything together. I was more trying to figure out how was that one lady tied to everything, and I'm honestly more intrigued about how she's tied to the whole thing than probably anything else. Like, I still think she's the leading cause.
Yeah. So, up to this point, yeah, I definitely feel like there's some kind of deal there, especially since she was at the funeral. And actually, asking about her, I did notice at the funeral that she was wearing some kind of mask. I don't know what to make of that. It kind of looks like a Raven mask a little bit, and you know, I know Edgar Poe, like, that was like a, it's like the symbolism with death when you do that. I also just noticed the name of each one of their episodes is named after one of his plays. The next one is The Mask of the Red Death. Or Mesquite. That's, you know, if you look further down, the Telltale Heart, famous one. So probably some big shit will be going there. So to my notes, we'll do the ratings. To my notes, I just wanted, if there is something demonic going on, I did notice that they killed the six kids in threes, which are most often numbers of, you know, of the devil. So, in movies and things like that. So that, I wanted to mention that I'm theorizing that this is a pretty light tone going into this so far, overall. And it's gonna, and I talked about this while we were watching this, that I think that it's gonna get darker as we go.
Yeah.
Some things that I felt like, that were, it was kind of a takeaway, a couple things. The fake cake TikTok trend, if they're planning on making this serious, they can't have stuff like that. And it takes away. It's like you're doing something that's based off Edgar Allan Poe, and then you're
the
having
a TikTok like
trend in that same
like
episode.
Make fun of it at the same time. Like, they're not like using it as part of the element, but they're like, oh,
I know. That part of it reminds me of like Romeo and Juliet, the one with Leonardo DiCaprio, where they're using guns.
That's
and
a
stuff.
Good movie, though. That's a good one. I like that one.
Yeah, just. I know, but just to modernize it, that's what that makes me think. It's cheesy. I'm gonna leave out that comment because it's offensive. But
we'll save that off.
I'll leave that one. I'll save that one off air. There is a lot, and I don't know if you got this or Mike, but there's a lot of tones, like undertones. That's very similar to the way Bly Manor and Hill House are. There is a like at one point they said letting the house rot. Like he literally did not maintain it. He locked it up, made sure nobody else was. That's exactly what happened with Hill House. Same thing with Bly Manor. They're doing a lot of. I mean, did you get that sense when you're watching it?
Yeah, like it had elements of both of them.
Yeah, which I'm sure they're doing that for people. There's all kinds of people that are looking for Easter eggs from the previous things to see if the universe is connected
right
or not.
In the background.
Yes. Yep, that same kind of signature thing. Bly Manor. Remember Bly Manor, whenever the guy who played Luke had the same scar from the injury that he got in Hill House? Like, people like, you love to see stuff like that, so. The Trail of Mud, that's the Bly Manor thing that went into the house. I was like, oh, that's a reference. Okay, so this was actually a funny goof. Do you remember whenever they went to the office and there was that guy that was sitting there? And I chuckled for a little bit and I was like, oh! It's not because I recognize that character from the other ones. I was very confused because I thought that was John Goodman at first.
That was John.
And then, you know John Goodman? Offhand, the dude from the bowling alley that pulls out the gun and all that stuff. I thought that was. I was like, what the hell? I like Googled it and I was like, oh,
that's not John Goodman.
And then the fucking. Okay, this is something I didn't like, but I'm sure he wrote about it originally. So the main dude, rich dude, whenever the detective came in, he said a single pour is twice your salary. Let's have a few drinks to see what your life tastes like. Like the worth of your life. And that's like a stereotypical bad guy, rich asshole thing yeah. that gets done a lot. I don't know. I mean, how did you take that scene in that way?
I mean, it kind of gave that tone a little bit, but I think I was still also trying to look at the surroundings and the setting at the same time because I was looking at the way the house was, and I was just like, okay. I know it's a different story, but Hill House, there's ghosts. the background is also still showing a story at the same time.
Yeah.
It's just, Flanagan's really good at monologues, and like, the way they do the monologues, and like, that's a big part of it, and so even the conversations between different people, it's like, oh my god, this is just, you know, it's good. I like the way they do this stuff. So those are my notes. Let's do an episode by episode and series like rating, and we'll kind of do it because Rotten Tomatoes rates them by episode. So we'll do a rating for the episode, rating for the series, how it stands. I'm putting it 9 for both of them. I think it's really good so far. It's got a good start to it. There's a couple nitpicky things I saw in there, TikTok thing, and you know, a little bit of dialogue. But I feel like it's a great start.
So I would probably have to say, I would probably have to say a 9 across the board too. I mean, like, it's a good pilot setter. It's just I feel like that it's weird that they're taking a story like one of Edgar Allan Poe's works and putting it into modern times. I think that's what my drawback from it is, because I went into this thinking that it was going to be set like in the 80s or like in the 60s, but it looks like it's being told from like a modern, like today time kind of term. And that's my only thing. I'm just like, I'm going to really be able to pull this off, because like it makes it a little rocky, but like,
and I remember at one time you had exactly said, this just wouldn't work in current day.
Like, it's, and then, yeah, boom, I was just like, I don't know if it'll work in current day, but like, we'll just have to wait and see. I'm just ready to play this next episode because this creepy lady keeps smiling at me.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, all right. Well, we'll close out this episode. If you want to, so this is Krieger Marsden signing out.
Signing out for episode 1.
And we will. We will see you after the next episode.